Okay, great. So my name is Mediano Centini. I'm here mainly with the C3 hat, although I work for a pay TV company as corporate development. In this very short presentation, I'm actually summarizing everything that I learned supporting social entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs in the region going for funding and actually approaching investors to get some money, basically. So it's nothing on pay TV and everything on enterprise and social enterprise that I've learned so far. The first thing that I want to do is just to get a sense of what you guys do in life. So how many entrepreneurs in the room? So almost all of you, which is great. And how many have already started fundraising activities or have thought of doing so? One only? Two? How was the experience?
I actually got funding from government first and then just finished a round of crowdfunding, and now I'm looking for a larger funding now.
Awesome, great. It's already quite of a good... So government and crowdfunding.
Yeah.
And now you're looking for...
private investment.
Venture capital, or okay. David, you also went for? Sorry, I'm calling you. It's just to have a sense.
We personally are looking for angel investors. It's a slow process.
Yeah, it's good to have some, some point of view from who's going through it as we speak. And please feel free to interrupt at any time. So what we'll go through today is, first of all, what are the stages at which you guys should go for funding, and what kind of sources of funding you should look at, for what size and amount of funds and so forth. So we'll just go through the typical cycle of funding, as well as the pros and cons of each investor or each type of funding. There is no perfect one, by the way, so there are pros and cons for everything. And then we'll go through some very practical examples of best practices, I would say, or worst practices when you approach investors as per our experience. And then a couple of thoughts at the end, and of course the Q&A. So the ideal journey that eventually everybody has in mind when we start an entrepreneurial journey is a pretty straightforward cycle. You have an idea, you go for some seed funding through different type of sources, then you launch a pilot or some pilots if the first one is not too successful. You have a product, you go to market. Eventually at that stage you will need some more cash to market your product, so to go out there. You grow, you scale, you exit, you become rich. Some of you, if any of you has a social mission embedded in the business model, of course you will picture yourself as also very impactful in your community. So that's a little bit what we have in mind when we start the journey. And I will say that's actually the reality of it. It's all ups and downs, and eventually you guys that have already started that journey, you can share your experiences. It's really never as predicted. It takes time, it's plenty of challenges, and that's what we will go through a little bit today with some examples as well. So funding is a little bit as a car gear. So you need enough cash to go to the next level. Not too much, not too little, otherwise it's like driving in fifth when you're going too slow, or vice versa, trying to run very fast with the second gear. So at each stage of your business, you need to ask yourself, what do you need to do to go to the next level, and how much money you need for that specific piece of the journey. It looks great from the outside. Of course, it looks much more complicated from the inside, and that's exactly what it is when you go for funding. That's actually the typical type of sources that you might look into. And I have two versions of it, depending on what's your business. So typically, when you are at an exploration phase and you have an idea, you go for self-funding, bootstrapping if you can afford, or you join an incubator that is doing seed funding. Anyway, normally for a pilot, and again, it depends on the business, of course. Some businesses require much more capital investment, but typically, in particular, if it's a technology business, a very scalable business, you start with a pilot, you get some little fund to do that, you validate your idea with some more money just to launch the pilot or to launch the soft version of your product, let's put it this way. And again, every time you kind of jump to different sizes of funds, and for each size of fund, you really need to go to the right type of sources. A lot of times, money is the same for us at this stage of the journey. So we kind of go with a blanket type of strategy. We reach to anybody that has some money for any kind of enterprise. And we end up burning, actually, some good connections for the following steps. So every time you find yourself in a situation where you need some cash and some money, ask, first of all, how much money you need for the next stage. Go for that size only and try to approach the investors or the entities that can give you exactly that amount to help you exactly at that stage of your journey. Avoid to go for venture capital that are actually looking for pretty established companies if you're still at a pre-seed level, and vice versa, of course. In particular in this region where you don't have a lot of, I would say, entities and organizations that are providing funds to entrepreneurs, although it's a much more crowded space now than a few years ago, so the trends the trends are good. In a few years we'll have many more, I'm sure. But in particular in this part of the world where everybody knows each other, just be mindful. And again, it's not too bad to approach different type of investors to get some feedback, but you might burn a little bit opportunities down the line, so just ask yourself. Now, if you are a social enterprise, and with C3 we focus on those, or if you're thinking of embedding a social mission in your business model, and it's very easy if your business is in healthcare, education, green energy, and so forth, there are other type of source of funding that could be definitely governments. Crowdfunding might work even better if you have a social mission. And then, of course, along the way, you have all sorts of donors and impact investors. And it's actually growing again very fast on that front. The nephew of Warren Buffett a couple of days ago, I don't know if you follow this kind of crowd, announced that actually is setting a big, probably the biggest in the world, social impact fund, and of course in the investor relation, in the investor relations world, this has been quite of a big news. So a lot of attention for entrepreneurs that have a social mission, and ethical investment is a growing market. So if your business is very close to having a social mission, I would argue it could be helpful in some cases, at least with some of those investors. I will go a little bit quickly through all the type and the pros and cons, and eventually some of you that have already experienced those kind of investors could help me out. Just to give a sense of the fact that every time you go in front of an investor, you want to ask yourself, what is the risk I can incur into? What is the downside of this type of investor? And just, I would say, protect your business and yourself from that kind of risks. So self-funding, bootstrapping, probably you already know. It's definitely an easy thing to start, an easy way to start your business. You control the risk completely because it's your money. Of course, it can go as far. It cannot really grow your business too much. So you self-fund at the beginning, but then you might want, if you want to scale, think of something else. And of course, you need to try to understand how much money you need for your personal living expenses as well. In the last financial modeling course we ran for our entrepreneurs, the speaker actually added to the Excel spreadsheet, a spreadsheet called the self self-sustaining finance or whatever it was. It was basically the bills of the entrepreneurs that you don't want to show to the investors, but you definitely want to kind of keep an eye on as well, because you don't want to reach a point where you kind of starve and you have to close your business. Same when you self-fund and you are still in your corporate job. That's actually my situation, which is good. On one side, you definitely feel a little bit more comfortable, you pay your bills, no issues, but the time constraints are tremendous. So sometimes you would like to meet that partner that could change your life as an entrepreneur, but you're stuck there because you're in the office until 6 p.m., you cannot really move. And it seems a silly thing to say, but it can really jeopardize your growth. So again, do it at the beginning, but then move it forward a little bit fast. And if you do it through, so if you sustain your business through consulting, make sure you have a balance in between the two, so that this doesn't jeopardize, again, the scalability of your business. Consulting, no matter how we think about it, is not scalable. So if you spend more than half of your time on the consulting side of things, using your expertise and your product or your service is kind of occupying 40% of your time as an entrepreneur, there is a red flag that should be raised. Friends, family, and fools. Easy to find, not really actually, but easier for some of us. You trust them, hopefully, in particular if it's family, but I would say it's still a business relationship in that case, so don't be too comfortable. And in some cases, if it's really good friends or good family members, you kind of feel a bit more comfortable. If you fail, they might just accept it in an easier way. Now, again, is this always true? Probably not. Be careful of mixing personal and business, always tricky. We have seen a lot of wives and husbands getting into difficult situations, and brothers and sisters. So not a very good thing if things go badly. Plus, not always, this type of investors, I would say, are not always very helpful in bringing connections and, again, bringing forward your business through partnerships, through networks and so forth. So it depends on which family members. And plus, if they're not accredited, which is something that in the investor world you have accredited and non-accredited investors, and they become shareholders with voting rights in your company, this can create some big major issues when you go for the next round, because the more official or more sophisticated investors will look at the shareholders that you already have in your business, and if they're not accredited investors, it might become a little bit of a tricky situation. So that basically do it as a job, and they have the license to do so. They need to respond to certain criteria. And again, I'm not an investor myself, so it's the details of it, I'm not sure what they are. But it's basically having a license to do so, having all the understanding of what are the rights of the... because again, imagine you have 30% of your company in the hands of, let's say, your brother. When an investor comes, it's already difficult to deal with the existing shareholders. In particular, if they have voting rights, they're not business people. They have not done investments before, and plus they might not respond to certain associations and so forth. They might not be the right person to deal with. So just watch out. Incubators, accelerators, great connection content. Most of the time you have a location that you can work with, so it's, we can work in, and it's a great support. And because I'm here, I shouldn't say too many cons. But normally they focus on early stage investment. So again, when you are a little bit more advanced, it's probably not the right investors. They have a standardized process that sometimes you need to follow, and this can be good for the same type of companies that they're targeting to. So if it's a technology incubator and you're a technology company, great. Otherwise, it becomes a little bit tricky to follow exactly the same type of speed and milestones that they require to basically keep your company within their incubator. And then in some cases, which is not the case of In5, and I'm serious about it, there are very tricky terms in the terms and conditions of their shareholder agreement. I have seen in the past, and that's, again, without names, but I've seen in the past some terms and conditions that require the entrepreneurs to leave the IP rights there to them if certain milestones are not met. So again, great to get some money, great to be part of an incubator, but to check out the terms and conditions very carefully. Hopefully you will have a lawyer as a friend that can help you through that kind of language. But it's really something you want to watch out before you sign anything.
Sorry,
in this part of the world, you normally have 25% to 30%. It's seed funding, so think about it. They have 100 entrepreneurs, you might have 5 or 6 that end up launching something meaningful, and that's more or less the percentages. So that's typical. So it's a very risky business for them. But it's not always the case. In Silicon Valley, you have all sorts of ranges. So you have even a 10% range. Normally, the size of investment is between $25,000 to $50,000. So that's more or less. So valuations are very small, anyway, at that stage, seed fund. Angels, in most cases, they bring contacts, connections. They bring advice and mentoring. They're flexible more than VC. So, of course, they have less restrictions than VCs. Now, they need an exit strategy. So when you approach them, unless, again, it's somebody very patient, but normally angel investors invest, and then after 3 to 4, maximum 5 years, they would like to get some return. So when you approach them, have an exit strategy in mind. Check the reputation. Again, getting in bed with people that eventually don't have a very good reputation for any reason could be a deterrent down the line for other investors to come in. And then make sure that legal fees are discussed up front, because it can be a big amount of money. And when it's a VC or an incubator or an accredited investor of any kind, normally they pay the legal fees. But with angels, it's always something that comes at the end of the process, and I promise it's not a very good surprise down the line. Crowdfunding, eventually we can ask, what's your name?
Orju.
Yeah. We can ask your experience with crowdfunding, if you can.
It's pretty good. I mean, it opens up your product to the world, right? So you get a lot of pre-orders and things like that, and a lot of good exposure. And then it sort of validates your market, and then you can go to an investor later and say, look, like there's demand for something like this, so it's.
May I ask, what's your business and what platform you use?
Yeah, we make wearable technology for people that are blind and partially sighted.
Nice.
So it's something really new, hasn't existed before, and we managed to get access to a lot of our market, and the response was really good. So we managed to reach our goal and exceed it as well. And now I just happen to be here, and I'm just talking to people and see if anyone's interested in this part of the world.
Did you go through Eureka or through Kickstarter? Or?
Indiegogo.
Indiegogo, okay, great. Nice, so we can ask a lot of questions afterwards. Social missions, as you can see, work well. It's not always easy on crowdfunding, or crowd investing, whatever it is. First of all, you need to have already, I would say, a little bit of an audience or a little bit of a crowd ready to support your, it's mainly word of mouth at the end of the day. So if you already have a bulk of followers, 20-30%, I would say, will be good. With a certain ticket each of the target that you want to reach, you have better chances. I've seen some entrepreneurs going with crowdfunding much earlier than after having creating a little bit of a base of followers. And in that case, the crowdfunding or crowd investing platforms can help until a certain extent. It's really setting yourself a little bit up for failure. So I will first create a little base of followers or fans, ambassadors, so that can actually help you in your crowd crowdfunding campaign in spreading the word and securing more investments. That's good. That's exactly what you were saying. Customer feedback early on, it's amazing. So it's a validation of your pro. Yes. Very good question. Now, if your product or service has an IP to be protected, so it's an invention, it's a specific design that you can protect with an IP, then make sure that before you tell the world you're doing such a thing, and in particular when you start sharing some details of it to a big crowd, that you have that protected. So you go, well, it's a bit expensive, but you can do some copyright, you can do some IP protection. If it's not the case, I wouldn't be too worried. Probably all of us in the past 10 years, we had so many ideas that we never launched, or that we launched and we never followed up with. Everybody has, I don't want to say similar ideas, but really an idea doesn't mean anything until it's not executed. So even if they copy your idea, it's fine, I would say, unless it's an IP, you know, to be protected, unless it's a technology invention, it's a specific design that you can protect. A little bit more difficult in this part of the world, but you can at least try legally. It's a risk. When entrepreneurs get to see three, the risk of people copying your idea, I mean, as soon as the word spread around, so in particular if they know that you are successful, so many will try to copy your idea. So it's part of the game, I guess. Of course, if you go too early stage, then the risk is higher than not. But there is no way to grow a company and get some funding and scale without sharing your idea around. When we are at C3, we match volunteers and experts with entrepreneurs. And some of the entrepreneurs are not even comfortable in sharing their ideas or their details with volunteers. And to be honest, it's not a very good sign of success, of potential success. Millions of people, you're right.
Not only mentors.
But they could be your customers, so depends what you're selling.
It's about the execution. This is why in Silicon Valley, they just
the more you share, the more you learn.
If you tell somebody can do it, it's like there is no competitive advantage on them. This is their model. Like all they talk about, Foursquare, Twitter, million times and in front of everybody. They don't care. And they share finance. I talk a lot, a very detailed one. It's like about the execution. If you don't have differentiation in terms of the execution.
Have you, Orgio, have you protected your idea, your technology?
All in place before launching.
Yeah. So you need to take some precautions, but just to move forward a bit quickly, otherwise we stay here all afternoon. But reputation risks, of course, if you go out there, you put yourself under the spotlight. Emotionally, it's pretty intense, I would say. You have really millions of people looking at your business, scrutinizing it, checking everything, and when you don't see, I was emotionally proven, like emotionally stressed when some of our entrepreneurs were going through crowdfunding. So I'm not even sure what it is to be the one there. It's not easy emotionally. It's a validation in itself. So when you don't see the target reached, it's kind of a little bit of a stressful situation. But at the same time, again, you need to be ready for it. At the end of the day, sooner or later, your product will be in the market, or it's already in the market and you want to bring it to other levels. I mean, that's something that sooner or later will happen. This is just increasing the emotional side and concentrating it in a 3-6 week campaigns. So it's, just be prepared for it. And then, of course, a lot of pressure on developing your product and developing your service in a very short period of time. When people put some money, even if it's $1,000 or $500, whatever it is, and eventually they will get an early the pre-order right or something as such, you need to be ready then to deliver. So they might get, as part of the crowdfunding or crowd investing campaign, they might get a product early on, or your service early on, or some discounts or whatever. So imagine you have at a certain point, all at a time, all these people getting your products. So you need to be ready to produce it, to sell, to bring it to them, to make sure that it works, and so forth.
Should you have at least a prototype or a minimum viable product before you go crowdfunding?
It depends on the crowdfunding platform. And also there is crowdfunding and crowd investing. Crowdfunding is normally doesn't require the company to give some equity to the crowd. While crowd investing, it's actually against a piece of equity, so already it's a little bit different. And sorry, you asked.
Yeah. I was back. Before someone goes to
okay.
Should he have at least
the idea, the prototype.
Again, he can start with an idea and then go crowdfunding.
You can start with an idea. Here in the region, we have a Flamna, for example. In this case, it's a lot of ideas that I'm seeing on that crowdfunding platform. It started as a media crowdfunding, so it was about movies and series and all those kind of media production type of stuff, but then they kind of open to other things. And you have a lot of ideas that go there, ask for $20,000-$25,000, things like this. If you go to Eureka, for example, in that case, they kind of look for companies that have at least a couple of years of operations, and they are already at a Series A type of investment. So in that case, I would say not only you need a prototype, you almost need the company to be running already, if not profitable, but close to break even. So it really depends on the crowdfunding. I'm not sure about Indiegogo. Probably you have all sorts of projects there,
yeah.
Right? Even Kickstarter, it's very
more
broad.
A social aspect on Indiegogo.
Yeah.
So, so Kickstarter is more just if you have a product, it's I just want to order the product and that's all I want from you. Indiegogo people can, you know, throw money for no reason, basically.
Okay. That's really depending on, yeah.
Yeah, isn't that Indiegogo only for a materialistic product, not for a software kind of product?
They have all sorts of things. The only difference with Indiegogo is that you have what's called flexible funding. So Kickstarter, whatever you say your goal is, you have to reach it. Otherwise, everyone gets their money back and you get nothing. With Indiegogo, you have even if you have a goal of 50,000 and you raise 30,000, you get to keep all the money and you still have to deliver something at the end of the day.
So is it also for the software product? I thought it's only for physical products, like which you can demonstrate.
It's everything.
It's everything.
Music, art, technology, anything.
And yes, some of the cons are the fact that in some cases, if you don't reach your target, you don't get anything, which is a little bit stressful. You spend maybe 2-3 months building all the campaign, and then you don't get a penny, and you get a lot of backlash in terms of reputation. So you need to be ready for it. High risk, high rewards. If it's crowd investing, yes, because basically you kind of, first of all, they go through a proper check because they have investors on the other side. So on crowd investing, there are a lot of legal checks. There are a lot of restrictions on the rights of the investors in terms of shareholders' rights on your side. It's actually good when you have a lot of people that want to invest small sums. Crowd investing, like for example Eureka, it's a good way to combine all of them in one shareholder so that you don't have 3 people or 30 people willing to say something in a confused way about what you should do with your product or your service, but they combine it in one shareholder that basically has one vote or whatever it will be, your governance. It's a good way. So in these cases, you have a lot of legal restriction. When it's just crowdfunding, it might really be that you need to deliver the product, and eventually, of course, they have terms and conditions. It's a little less intense. Again, it really depends on each platform. Loans, credit, in this part of the world, be careful. If you don't pay back your loans, you go to jail. So before getting a loan, in particular the loans that I've seen at 25% interest rate, just watch out before you sign anything. Sometimes we might be a little bit desperate for money, but just check it properly. Even the good guys are asking that kind of interest rate, and it's just because there is a high risk involved in lending money to entrepreneurs. So make sure, of course, you take the control, you don't give any shares. They have far-reaching rights. Again, in this part of the world, it's even you know, a criminal offense, so be very careful. But again, it could be good if you have already a strong operation and you know very well your cash flow. And it's quite of a steady cash flow. We have an example, for example, one of our company, Liquid of Life. They got a loan, they're repaying it you know, every month, no issues whatsoever, even if it's an interest rate. So make sure you do it when you're ready for it. This is content and connections, a lot of advice and mentoring. Normally they give a bit more money than the previous ones. In this case, you have many restrictions. Similarly to what mentioned in the crowd investing side of things. And for restrictions, in particular when things go bad, they have a lot of rights with your IP, with your assets and all of this kind of stuff. Plus, sometimes, and again, the money is there, it's locked in for you, but it is released in a vested way, so you don't get the money right away. You need to prove yourself, and pressure from VCs is terrible, in particular if you have 2-3 VCs together at the same time, which is what I've seen so far in this part of the world. They put a lot of pressure from right and left, and you need to respond to those kind of requests at any point in time. They have the right to do so. And then, of course, you lose a little bit of control of your decision-making process. It's not anymore I work for myself. It's a little bit of a different... This is more for either very seed stage or social entrepreneurs. There are plenty of grants, fellowships, and probably it's... Again, sorry, I'm using you as you were part of the... But it's great to just have living example in the room. Government support normally comes very early on. Or if you have a social mission, you have some benefit for the community, it might be easier to get some government support or grants or fellowship. Again, it's a very time consuming, and it's normally a project-based type of funding. So you need to make sure that the project you have pitched for in the very first place kind of stay alive for the length of the grant. Donors, that's only for people that really set up businesses that have a social mission as well. It can happen. It's illegal here if you don't have a non-profit license, but you can do it through those few non-profits that exist. The only downside is that they keep a big chunk of the proceedings, but you can do it. Just again, watch out. And now there is a decree from last year, a new decree that requires a specific approval from CDA, which is the Community Development Authority. So again, make sure that you're going through the right procedures. It can be very risky these days. But it's something that for social entrepreneurs is definitely a very good source of funding. Impact investors are just investors that look at the social mission as well. Make sure you have in place a social impact measurement before you go in front of these guys, a strategy at least, and you have started gathered some data, because they will look at it. I'm going a bit faster because I have some more stuff to say afterwards. A few names, it's definitely not exhaustive. Eureka we mentioned, Aflamna we mentioned, In5 of course, our partner. We do have investors, which is Angel Investor Network. Turnate is another accelerator, Fraxis Labs. You also have some of the companies, and I don't see OSN here, but maybe soon, that are also putting some money into startups. For example, STC Ventures is probably one of the most active in the region. STC is a telecom operator from Saudi, and they're putting really a lot of investment into the technology side of the entrepreneurial sector. Any questions so far on top of the ones can I go on? Now, a few very practical examples of what's, I would say, a no-no, or what's best practices when you reach the point of deciding to go for a specific type of investors. It's very practical. It's really collected from observing our entrepreneurs going into this kind of process. So don't expect a lot of numbers. It's just some tips for you to remember. First of all, check the investment fit. There are investors that are looking for a specific type of entrepreneur. It could be technology, they're focusing on this. It could be that they're focusing on green technology, or they have two or three sectors of preferences or type of entrepreneurs. And plus, they might have a specific focus in terms of geography. So some of them might not be interested in a specific set of countries. They might be interested in other countries where you're not operating. So again, check those kind of things a little bit beforehand, so you don't lose 3 months of time preparing for that meeting and then you discover that they're not interested. Investment stage, we already said. The financing instrument, in this part of the world, a lot of so-called investors, they actually give convertible loans. It's not direct investment. That means that they can exercise the right of transforming that investment, which is against your equity, into a loan. And you go back to what we were saying about loans. So if you don't repay back, you go to jail. Just make sure that the investors that you approach has the right product for you. In this part of the world, most of the investments are actually not pure investments, are convertible loans, so it's a little bit of a different thing.
What is the best way to let them in?
But the best way would be just to give a piece of equity for cash, all together. But it's a bit of a dream, so I will not expect a lot of those to be ready to do so. Again, they take a lot of risks, so for them a convertible loan is a very good option, because if at a certain point your company is not really providing the return on investment that they have.
What about the founder? What type of financial tools to give them for the founder within your company, like the CTO? Like, what is the recommended tool to give them?
Some equity?
Yeah, is it like, because like most of the...
I have a few Excel models that include a lot of different criteria.
Okay.
If you are the founder, you started that company, you had the idea, you created your business model, you started, maybe you launched a pilot, and then somebody else come in as an employee for a while, and then you really like working with that person, you want to bring him or her into the equity pot. My advice, very practical advice, first of all, vest the equity. So in particular, if you need that skill for more than 1 or 2 years, write a shareholder agreement where the equity is released. It's a bit of a painful process, but it's released against some milestones.
Okay.
Milestones of the co-founder, but also milestones of the company itself, right? So that everybody is working towards the same goal. The second criteria, I would say, is he or she putting some money? So depending on the valuation of your company at that stage, the money means it's equal to a certain amount of equity. Now, when you are at a very early stage, it's a little bit tricky to be so specific. Although those Excel models, there are a few versions of them, I'm happy to share, are pretty useful because they're really giving some scores to every single thing that you do. Who's the CEO, who's the CFO, who's managing the critical things of the enterprise.
The valuation on the early stage, it's like, it's not something like solid, like you just give them, okay, my company, like most of this, this company valuation is $10 million, so you just have...
I know. Now, if the person doesn't put any money, forget about the valuation, you just share the equity depending on who has done what, who's doing what, and what's the role.
Legally, is this something considered within, like, if you go for a T-Corp or something?
Shareholder agreement is between yourself, but better to have a lawyer involved.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, better to have a lawyer.
Because by the end of the day, the company is registered under the founder name, not the co-founder.
The only thing that will be required is that for example, if you are in a free zone, let's say Virtu zone, they will require certain documentation to release the equity. So you will have two shareholders legally. There will be one which has a certain power or
something. And the other one is an internal one.
But when you start sharing equity, you have the two names legally registered in your
certificates.
Yeah, you have share certificates. You have you have really, even when you go to open an account, they will ask for this kind. It's properly done, but they will not look at your shareholder agreements. They don't really care what's your plan for the vested equity or whatever else. That's something that you sign between each other at an early stage. Then when investors come in, accredited investors come in and official investors come in, it's become a little bit more complicated. But the licensing body just need to know how much of the company you have and how much of the company the other person have. That's it. Yeah. Okay. Stock options.
Stock options, but
it's like vested interest. So the longer they work, they get
more. It's more for employees than for co-founders in general, right? It's the same principle. So it's vested equity, but is linked to how do you want to release the stock options. There are very complicated ways of doing so. It's normally when the stock option has already a value attached to it. So it's mainly used for bigger companies. And you can just give a little bit of vested equity to employees as well. Normally, if you have an MD, so you are the founder and you're hiring a CEO, you go for 5 to 8%, and again, I'm giving the grammar recipe right here. So you want to discuss that properly with the person. But in general, it's between 5 and maximum 10% of the company. Normally 5 to 8. When it comes to chief technology officer, that might be very important for your company because it's a technology company. You might want to go between 3 and 5%.
What is the recommended pool for all the co-founder other than the real founder? Is it like, is there a rule of thumb or?
Yeah, not more than, other than the co-founder, I wouldn't give more than 10 to 15%.
But like, I just saw an example in the US, it's not less than 20%. They don't.
To one person, to
no,
one
like
employee? Overall. Yeah, definitely not more than 20%. Definitely not more. And again, it's the same principle when you have angel investors or friends and families and fools. You don't want to get stuck and not being able to take any decision whatsoever because you have 30 people you need to involve in. So you give the share, but you don't give the rights of. So the governance is to be structured in a little bit of a different way. But at the same time, also for new investors, when they see that there are 10 people with more than 20% of the company, it becomes very tricky to get more investment afterwards. So 20 the maximum. And again, I'm. Yeah. A little stake. Exactly. It depends who's the advisor. If it's Mediano Scientini, no. No equity. But if it's somebody from Silicon Valley, I don't know, the CEO of. Exactly. In that case, you want to just bring, I mean, their talent or their connection might have such a big value for your company. It's so difficult to give you a percentage, but if it's such a critical, and again, it might not be the right person to become the CEO, the MD of your company, or the CTO. But you want to bring him in with a vested interest so that he can open a lot of doors? Yes. you know, 10, 20% again. And if there are also investors in the pot, I mean, discuss with the investors what will be.
He's
investors and advisor. Okay, then fine, yeah. You can calculate, now, no, even when you give some equity to your employees, I will say you look at what's their value in the market. Really, what could be their salary in the market? Normally, you will give a little bit less than that salary because, again, it's a startup. You will calculate. It seems very complicated, but it's not, I promise. You kind of give a little bit of a value to the company, and you calculate that gap between the salary and the market value out there, and you give that specific piece of equity. If the value of the company is still a flying bird, in that case you benchmark towards other people that have some equity and their value in the market.
But
and again,
it's not a startup, it's a company. Like, what is the definition of the startup? Is it the revenue? Is it the number of the employee? Or like,
when you don't have, when you're still not break even, the revenues are still a little bit of trial and errors.
But if it's a profitable within 3 months?
If it's a profitable company, quite sizable, then it's a little bit of a different story, yeah. Then you can run a valuation. I mean, again, and you can, with the shareholders' agreements and so on, you can always have, I think it's called I don't know the right term, but you can assign a third party, and again, don't go for an investment banker, but you can assign a third party to give his own independent valuation. So you might have your valuation, the other co-founder has another valuation, so you want to bring in a third party. In the shareholder agreement, you will say who's assigning the third party, what happens if we don't agree on the third party to be assigned, and so forth. So you kind of discuss those things up front. I hope I am helping. Yes.
So yeah, about the financing instrument that you mentioned before, equity versus convertible loan. You know that in an early stage company, you have on one side an investor who wants 99% of the company for the money puts, and the other side you have a founder who wants to keep 99% of the company and have the highest valuation possible. So you know, like there is not much.
It doesn't look like a very good situation,
yeah,
but anyway.
Like,
don't fight too hard.
You have to agree on evaluation.
Yeah.
But I think that a convertible loan, especially the ones that Y Combinator has done lately, they're called SAFE. These ones are very valuable and very
absolutely
nice because you don't have a valuation right now, so you just take money, and the next step, when you know, in 1 year, when you start to have I don't know, revenues or
absolutely no, I'm not.
You
yeah,
you can convert that in equity, given another investment.
Yeah,
the valuation at the time too, let's say.
Yeah, it's a very good instrument. It gives you the flexibility down the line if you have enough cash to avoid giving equity of something really valuable. I mean, it's a double-edged sword because you. What I was referring to, and I assume, are you all from the region? Or you? Ah, exactly. So in this part of the world, if you don't pay your loans, you go to jail.
But you put the company in Singapore.
Exactly. So if you want to get a convertible loan, and you're still not sure about your cash flow, a convertible loan is great when you know you can pay back and you are pretty sure about it. But if it's a really risky, and again, I'm just giving advice, you know, so that I don't feel bad if something like this happened. In particular, if you remember me and I didn't mention that or something, I'm just kidding. But you can create an entity, let's say, elsewhere, where if this happens, that can happen when you have a startup, to be honest. It happens all the time. That at a certain point you go bankrupt. In particular in the US, there are plenty of options when you go bankrupt is actually part of the process of there are bankruptcy, family bankruptcy insurances and policies in the US. So just before you sign a convertible loan, make sure that you know exactly what you're going into. So in this part of the world, I will just be a bit more cautious because it can happen that you cannot repay back. I know, that's the issue.
You want investors from,
sure.
China,
yeah.
USA.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
They don't even let you put the company in Dubai.
Totally agree. Totally agree. And things are changing, so eventually in a few years this will not be valid anymore. We could have investors that stop just having convertible loans and packaging them as direct investment, which is the big issue. And eventually we can have in the very near future some more instruments that are not putting your life at risk, I would say. Yeah. And also, if it's a capital intense type of business, watch out more than if it's a very scalable technology business. I know I'm a bit late.
Yes, I just wanted to interrupt and
yes.
say that we have just spoken to the next speaker and the third speaker. 15 minutes, if everybody is okay with it. So we take extra.
Thank you.
Minutes,
yeah.
If you're okay.
Yeah. Absolutely.
And then the next, yeah, I know. So we just, you know, let the flow go. And so 15 minutes extra.
Okay.
Already arranged with the other speakers.
Thank you so
and,
much.
Thank you.
Lots of questions, yeah. Thank you. Okay, we'll go very fast at this point. Set a reasonable time frame before you go in front of investors. Perfection is in your head, it doesn't exist, it's a concept, it's not a reality, so you will never be perfect, but give yourself a little bit of lead time, don't burn opportunities. Target a decent size of market when you go in front of investors. At the end of the day, they are there to make money through your company. They're not there to help you personally. So your business needs to make some sense. And don't go there with these billions of dollars that the sector is generating. In particular, if you are in Middle East, it's a much smaller size of those billions of dollars. It doesn't really look that reasonable. If you have competitors, and goes back a little bit to your questions at the very beginning, if you have competitors, new or potential, or even established one, check out what they do, be aware of them. Don't say, I don't have any competitor, in particular in front of investors, but don't get obsessed by them. You just want to differentiate your product, and it could be done at a marketing level even, or at a value proposition level. Differentiate your product and you will be fine. Competition sometimes is good because it makes us smarter. Okay, projections, lot of things to say there, but make sure they don't look too aggressive, that they look positive, because I've seen entrepreneurs going in front of investors with revenues going like this. I'm not sure why, but that's a no-no. You need to be positive, even with the numbers. And cost your own salaries, cost your, the salaries of your own employees, even if at the moment you're not giving them any money. Yeah.
Aren't they trying to show that you, it's not a lot about money, it's more about users, and I've acquired this much about users, is that a good thing?
For yeah.
Investors? And that's why you require the money.
Yeah, if it's a digital business, so technology-based digital user business, yes. If it's a brick and mortar, not really, no.
Yeah.
So it depends on the business.
When you say I got traction, so they got
much more. Yeah, on digital, look, valuations, and we have all followed all sorts of valuation from Twitter to Facebook to whatever, Zynga and all of this. They value the company based on users because it's potential revenues down the line. Now, when you are a startup and you're not Mark Zuckerberg, it's a little bit more difficult to just base it on users. Again, it depends. If it's a copycat of an idea that already worked out there, it's easier. If it's a brand new idea, a bit trickier. But if you have at least you need to have some revenues somehow. Even if it's very embryonic, let's imagine you have 1 million users a month, and from these 1 million users you just launched, a new product or a new service, and you're starting making money out of it. That's perfect. The 1 million users are your potential revenue stream, so that's perfect. It depends. Can take it offline. This I forgot. Ask the right amount of money. Don't ask too much. That's for two reasons. On one side, it's more difficult. The more the money, the more difficult. On the other side, I mean, it doesn't happen often, but when you get a chunk of money altogether, you get a bit less smarter about it. So you start spreading it on PR and on a lot of things that eventually are very good, but you you create an organization that is a bit less lean than what it could be if you just go for the right amount of money. So again, we wish we were all in that situation. So it's one of those comments a little bit for a few of us. And the other one, actually, it's probably most of us don't run out of cash. That's dreadful for your business. Co-founders are a blessing. You're not Superman. Yes.
Sorry, it's about the previous slide. Not to ask too much of funding. So when you prepare to ask some funding, is it what's the typical duration that you can plan for example, 12 months?
I have some examples in a second on the typical time frame, which is not a very good news, but sorry. So you're not Superman. Find a co-founder if you can. Test the co-founder before on a specific project, at least 6 months, if not 1 year. People, you know, show their bad sides after a while, not in the first 3 weeks. And if you can have in mind already an organization down the line, is better, so that you fill in, even with the co-founders, the skills that you really need for your business down the line. Partnerships, the merrier, the better. To rely on one or two partners only, or to kind of have only one supplier or one distributor in your business is very risky, because you put all the all your eggs in that basket. So try to diversify a little bit your partnerships, and again, make sure that those are good partners, good credibility in the market, and you know, a good reputation. In particular, in this market, which is based in a lot of word of mouth, do a triple check on whoever you partner with. In particular, if you're a social enterprise, those type of relationships will be scrutinized from right to left. And again, if you want to fly, hang out with eagles and not with the chickens. So that's one of those things we want to keep in mind. I will skip that a bit more briefly. This is more for the social entrepreneurs in the room. It's possible to merge and align social mission. And I'm so glad that you have such a product that you mentioned, because that's a perfect way to do so, to have a good impact on the community with your business. Now, when you picture yourself, and probably you didn't do that yet. Sorry, I'm using you as he will ask me some fee at the end. But when you picture yourself as an angel or a good person, for some reason human nature is such that you will be scrutinized more than everybody else. I don't know what's this kind of reaction from the market, but that's what it is. If you picture yourself as a social entrepreneur, you will get more scrutiny. So make sure that all your business 360 degree is ethical, is doing the right thing, is not treating bad employees or some suppliers, is not partnering with, I don't know, the Coca-Cola of the moment. I've seen very ugly things happening to social entrepreneurs trying to do something good, to be honest. So it's a bit unfair, but just make sure you are ready for it. And then one last point before some examples, so I will respond to you in a second. Be positive, keep trying. There is a research that I found a little bit randomly, so I'm sure there are plenty of others. But and this is for all of our life situations. Apparently, happiness is due to circumstances only for 10%. Then it's a bit of genetic and a bit of internal state of mind. So when you feel very down, think about that. It's not eventually the circumstances you are in, it's more your state of mind. So try to keep it easy and to keep it, you know, I think that's the expression in English, sorry. Just, you know, take it easy. That's the right expression, sorry. Whatever. But stress can be very high in this kind of situation. Keep it cool. You should have fun doing, you know, being your own boss and doing your own business, setting up a new company. It shouldn't ever be a tragedy, unless you have a loan in some part of the world where you get to jail if you don't repay, then I understand. But otherwise, keep it cool, should be fun. And plus, try to not give up easily. And I give you some example of what it means giving up or not giving up. You don't want to reach the diamond pot and 2 meters before or like 10 centimeters before just give up. The most successful entrepreneurs I've seen so far, we have some in the room, by the way, are the ones that never give up. It's not the best idea, it's not, and going back to that, it's not the best idea, it's not sometimes a good execution, that's important also, it's necessary but not sufficient. It's really the entrepreneurs that never give up, that don't care about having doors shut in front of them, they just keep trying. And a few examples. Carpool Arabia and is part of IN5. I'm so proud of these guys. They have done a crowdfunding, and I know Benjamin is not fuzz around. Yeah, he's around. He talked about it. So these guys, apparently, so they did a did he spoke about Eureka? I'm glad, yeah. He's amazing. Exactly, yeah. These guys, their two co-founders, never gave up. They did a crowdfunding campaign, didn't go that well. At that point, we were, because they're part of C3 as well, we were all a little bit worried. It's like, oh my God, that's really bad. They started the day after knocking at doors of investors. They pitched to 60 investors in like 6 months. I don't know how they did it. And in the end, they were successful in securing quite of a big chunk of money, and they're already going for the next round. So that's
a
two investors, yeah, one from France and one from the region. So that was perfect. A media company in the region, yeah, yeah, very successful, a very good example. But it took overall basically 1 year or so, maybe 9 months between the ones that went bad and the ones that went well. Glambox, some other friends of ours, they had already 3 rounds of funding. The first was an easy one, group of friends and family, not fools, because the company is going very well. The second round was 3 VCs, and the third round is actually other VCs, a little bit bigger, again, a combination of them. They are in constant fundraising mode, so every cycle more or less has been about 1 year time. So again, it's a long process and tedious and difficult. These are the Eureka crowd investing success stories. So as you can see, it's plenty of them. I took that not because I like Eureka more than Kickstarter, but I will say they have got a lot of good stories. So when people say there are no investors in the region, I knocked at a few doors and nothing, and then they knocked at maybe 2 doors with a financial model that doesn't look that great. So don't listen too much, just go for your own strategy, and if you don't give up, you will be successful. Word of wisdom. Very good question. It's very important for crowdfunding more than for other type of funding, but it's always important. And again, put yourself in the shoes of the investors. They want to make some money, and they want to make sure that they're putting the money in the hands of somebody strong, credible, and solid. So the more credibility you already have in the market, the better. It doesn't matter if you're friends or family of those people, but definitely they will ask around how honest you are, how serious and committed you are, and so forth. So being part of accelerators is a very good thing, because it's kind of a stamp of credibility, and having won some awards or some competition is also good. And again, if I'm an investor, I feel more comfortable to invest in somebody that I know other people believed in the very first place. So very important.
And you need to build it like a minimum viable product. You have to build it
Yeah, again, they want to have the comfort, it's a variable thing. Minimum viable product means the minimum set of functionalities or the minimum set of services that you need to prove your point. So the roughest thing you can put in the market without, I would say, looking too bad, which a customer will be ready to pay. That's a little bit what the minimum viable product is. Today, if I finish on time, you will have a lean startup. I read somewhere lean startup principles type of. So if you stick around, you will know what a minimum product, viable product is. Okay, word of wisdom. And it sounds bad, but being cheap is a very good thing at the beginning. Be careful about every single penny you spend. It will create a lean startup, which is really what you want down the line. And also give be quick, be energetic and reactive. Don't wait to do things the next year when you can kind of act right away. So be fast and be cheap, basically. That sounds very bad for the ones that just joined now, but anyway, word of wisdom too. Birds fly, fish swim, and deals don't go through. That's the word, that's nature. So don't feel bad if certain deals fall apart. It's really not a big deal. That's what happens to deals, in particular in the investment side of things, and never give up. And that's it. Sorry, I took more time for questions. Thank you.